understand that, there's not. You say, well, it's a lesson for me. Well, we're not trying, this is not a church here. We're not trying to give you a lesson in life, but if there's a lesson to be gotten out of this, these are the kinds of things that he's trying to disseminate, isn't it? And the third one then is old age. Let's see what we can see what he says about old age. Or rather, the fourth one is old age. So at the end of your journey of learning, without warning, old age creeps up on you. It's the cruelest one, as most of us may imagine. And I think everyone knows that that's going to be tough whenever they come up to it. There's very few who do a good job on that one. But when a man has no fear, that sounds just like the Bhagavad Gita now. In fact, I could just transfer this into the Bhagavad Gita to sound the same writing. It sounds exactly the same. No more impatient clarity of mind, a time when all his power is in check. It's also a time when he has an unyielding desire to rest. He gives totally to his desire to live down, forget, soothes himself in his tiredness. His desire to retreat will overrule all his clarity, his power, his knowledge. But if a man bluffs off his tiredness, lives his fate through, he can then be called a man of knowledge. Only for a brief moment, when he succeeds in fighting off his last invincible enemy, the moment of clarity, power, and knowledge is enough. Well, that's a hopeful thought. Would it were true? Would people were able to do that? But it's true. I mean, when you do see old people who have achieved this state and are not like reduced by age to, a miserable condition, but have kept their dignity and the clarity of their mind and things like that, it is an impressive sight. You say, well, what's the point? You're going to all meet the same fate anyway. I think these things are a matter of, I've often told my students from my point of view, a matter of taste. How you want to live, how you want to appear in your life. Whether you want your life to look like something elegant and dignified, or you want your life to look like a cesspool, basically. It's just a matter of taste, how you choose to live on an aesthetic level. Aesthetics means what you consider to be beautiful and what you consider to be ugly or low. People don't reckon that in often enough in people's behavior. People think that you need a god to tell you how to behave rightly. Personally, I don't think you need anything like that. All you do, and I don't think ancient men or women needed these things in order to know what high behavior was as opposed to low behavior. We have a natural instinct in us. It's nothing to do with a god or anything that puts it there. This is the way human beings are. And you either respect them, you can have a total pagan, or anyone else, Christian, non-Christian, Buddhist, Jew, whatever, behaving in an elegant, impressive way, or a low manner. You can have people lopping off people's heads, and you know that that's cowardice. Take a defenseless, innocent person and make them sit and grovel and beg before you. So you don't have to have a religious training to know that. It's innate. Even on a football field, people know the difference between someone who's behaving in an admirable way or not. And it goes through life. So to my mind, these things are aesthetics and they go right up to your old age. You can choose to face these challenges in a high-minded, clear-minded way, or you can choose to be reduced by them. And I think most people, if they have their brothers, would like to do it the first way. So I think these things help fine, but whatever helps you to do it. But maybe that's the best we can do in life. I mean, my sermon for the day. Let's go on here now to, I think we're going to come in here to his expedition here. They're still talking in December here about the devil's weed, which supposedly have to do with living properly. Mescalito as a protector, January. So is he a god, 59, and the only god, or is he one of the gods? He's just a protector and a teacher. He is power, he's not a god, he's not anything else. Why don't you tell me more about Mescalito? I can't tell you anymore. There must be thousands of things to say. No, there's nothing you have to know. As I've already told you, he's not the same for everyone. Well, we've heard this before. So let's see, where does this expedition begin? I think it's on page 60, is it there? Friday, July 6, 1962, is that when he goes out? I think it is. So we don't really, we could just talk about this, but I think his description of this search for Mescalito is the high point of the book. I don't know, we've been looking at it, and I don't consider this a great book necessarily, though you might like it, and it may be pretty good as far as you're concerned, and I'm not against your liking what you read. Don Juan and I started our trip in the afternoon of Saturday, June 23rd. So you see, he's writing this down 3 weeks later, or 2 weeks later anyway. We were going to look for unguitos. Who's Spanish here? How do you pronounce unguito? Is that right?